time you want.
Okay, well, I just thought maybe you've got a question or something, I'll give you a chance for it.
Real quick, so you left one, and then you left in 1967.
Yes,
I came home
in August, actually I got home August 24th of 1967. I had, I'll back up and tell you a little bit of history about Mrs. Monica's mother. We had known each other. We'd grown up together, went to the same church, but she was like 6 years younger than me. So, you know, when I was a senior in high school, she's a sixth grader. You know? Not somebody you're going to date. But while I was gone, she grew up. You know? And anyway, I was going with a young lady from Warsaw, and she wrote me every day. I mean, like, we got there and our mail caught up with us that first night, and we're out there with jeeps shining lights in and getting our mail, and I'm getting all this. I mean, I had a stack of mail like this because she wrote to me every day, and the guys are like, some of them got one letter, you know, and I got this whole stack, and they're like, what in the world is it? But anyway, so she wrote every day, so I had a stack of mail from her, you know, constantly. But along about January of 1967, all of a sudden I didn't get any mail, and from her. And a couple weeks went by, and I wonder what's going on. Well, I get this letter, Dear Steve. Well, she never started her letters, Dear Steve. There's something going on here. Well, obviously. And she had constantly, one of the things, she wanted to get engaged, and I thought, I will not get engaged until I know I'm coming home. You know, I just, you know, it wasn't that I didn't want to get engaged to her, I wasn't going to do that when I was in a war zone, not knowing, you don't know from one day to the next what's going to happen. So, even in a base camp, you're in a situation where you might not make it. So I thought, I'm not going to get engaged until I know that I'm going home. And, well, obviously, she found somebody who would get engaged, so she sends me this letter, and, of course, my mother was really worried about me, you know, thinking I might be despondent. Actually, I kind of was relieved, because I wasn't getting this mail, honestly, that wanted to get engaged, and it was positively the best thing. So my mother talked to my wife now, Joyce, Kristen's mother, and told her she should start writing to me. Well, she had written even before that. But what I didn't know, obviously, her brother, her oldest brother, was one of my best friends. We ran around together. So I was at their house a lot. But what I didn't know is she always had a crush on me. You know, I didn't find that out until years later. But she said when I went to Vietnam, she cried herself to sleep thinking I'll never see him again. And anyway, so when this happened, she started writing me. And so when they came to O'Hare Airport to pick me up, she went along, and then we soon started dating, and the rest is history. But anyway, it obviously worked out very well. This year will be 49 years we've been married, so in November. But do you have any questions? I mean, you do ask away. If you don't, you might have to take that test yet.
I didn't make it.
My having a 10-page paper is helping you guys out.
Don't be afraid. I know you probably have good questions.
I was thinking, so kind of to place in the war, you were there early, mm-hmm. and then we were talking about, like, the Tet Offensive would have happened later, so
right
you might hear about that.
Right after I left, in fact.
But we still had a lot of casualties before that.
Oh, yeah. See, that's the thing. But, now, even though we had a lot of casualties here, I think in this 4th Platoon, even though it was 100% casualties, there was only, I think, 12 killed, including Sergeant Grandstaff and Foreman. Now, if you look at the wall, as much as they can determine, the wall has them in the order of their being killed. So therefore, Jim Foreman and Sergeant Grandstaff are not too far apart on that wall. I think Jim Foreman is first. I think Sergeant Grandstaff is a few after him. But they're listed in the order as best they can determine that they were killed. So that's how that wall goes. But yeah, there was a lot of casualties before, a lot of fatalities before the Tet Offensive. Of course, it got much more heated. And right before I left, they called us together for a meeting, and they let us know that they knew that the North Vietnamese had rockets in Cambodia, which were capable of reaching our base camp, which our base camp was about 30 miles from the Cambodian border, which is, you know, that's not that far. So we knew they had the capability. In fact, I have a video at home, a little gruesome, I didn't bring it, but a friend of mine who was, he came over in August of 67, and I since met him down at Kokomo at the Vietnam Veterans Reunion down there. I guess you could show him my new story.
Yeah.
He was there because he came in about the time I left, just before I left, but I never really met him that I know of anyway. But he was there, and he has pictures of right outside the barracks that I stayed in, or the tent at that time, a dead Vietnamese soldier who had actually, I don't know how he got in there, because there were 9 levels of perimeter concertina wire and all kinds of barbed wire, 9 layers of that. It was as far as you could see. I mean, they'd have a layer of that, and then they'd have a little open space. Another, you know, concertina wire is just rolled up wire that you see laying on the ground. I mean, it has like razor sharp edges on it. But anyhow, somehow he had gotten through all that and was killed, and he has pictures of that. But our base camp never got hit the whole time I was there. Now, Camp Holloway, which is actually, it was right outside of the town of Pleiku. We were about 8 miles south of Pleiku, up near what was called Dragon Mountain. I think I might have a picture of that. In fact, the first name of our base camp was Dragon Mountain Base Camp. But shortly after, it was named Camp Inari. So if you ever look that up, that would be the same thing, Camp Inari. And that was named after the first lieutenant who was killed over there out of the 4th Division. They named it after him. I forget what his first name was, but his last name was Inari, E-N-A-R-I, anyway.
Yeah, you want to tell about, like, what would be on the
uniform
there?
Yeah.
I can
look
up.
Okay. Well, obviously, everybody wore the U.S., which signified the U.S. Army, and then this... on this is the transportation, which is what we consider part of the transportation maintenance. Our unit patch here, 4th Infantry Division, you put it on the left side. When you're in the military, you wear it on the right side. After you've served in a war, you wear it on the left side. That's in case you're reassigned to a different unit, you put that on the right side. But you always wear this because you served in a war. This is a Spec 4 patch, which is as high as I got. My group leader told me that I was the best electrician he had. He said, they had an opening for a Spec 5. He said, you should get it. But he said, I'm going to give it to another man. His name was Gordon Dubler. He was from out in Washington somewhere. He said, because he's married, and he said he's also enlisted. He's going to have a longer service, so I'm going to let him have it. He said, you should get it. But it was nice just knowing I should get it. This was something like a, what do you call it, an ascot or something. This is what you wore.